Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, my dear students. Today we are going to talk about peripheral nerve injuries. This is the anatomy of a peripheral nerve. These are bundles of axons conducting afferent impulses from cells in the anterior horn of the spinal cord to the muscles, and afferent impulses from peripheral receptors via cells in the posterior root ganglion to the cord. All motor axons and sensory axons are coated with myelin sheath, interrupted with nodes of Ranvier. Outside Schwann cells, axon is covered by a connective tissue stocking called endoneurium. The axons that make up a nerve are separated into bundles, fascicles, by fairly dense membranous tissue, the perineurium. And the group of fascicles that make up a nerve trunk are enclosed in the even thicker connective tissue coat called the epineurium. This is what is we have just described. Individual nerve fibril covered by endoneurium, a group covered by perineurium, and the nerve covered by epineurium. So areas hypoesthesia due to nerve injury may be less than area of skin supplied by that nerve because of overlap of sensory supply. Autonomous zone is a relatively small area of complete anesthesia, and these zones are found in all nerve injuries. Right, this is the sensory territories and innervations on your left on volar margin, and on the right your dorsal view. So just go through them. Next, motor innervation of limb muscles, essential for diagnosis of nerve injury. Points to remember: remember the nerve supply to a particular muscle, difference muscle supplied by nerve, and action of a muscle. By what maneuvers can one appreciate its action in isolation? So anatomical features relevant to nerve injuries, relation to surface. Superficial nerves are more prone to injury by external objects like median nerve in the wrist. Relation to bone, radial nerve injury in fracture humeral shaft. Relation to fibrous septa, nerve may get entrapped in septi. Relation to major vessels and course in a confined space, for example median nerve compression in carpal tunnel. This is a pathology showing degeneration and regeneration. So just go through it and remember. So mechanism of injury are cut and laceration, electrical injury, infection, ischemic injury, compression, traction and friction, toxic agents, cooling and freezing, radiation injury, and injury and dislocation most common is thermal injury. So classification of nerve injury is a transient ischemia, neuropraxia and axonotomesis and neurotomesis. This is Seddon's classification. So transient ischemia is due to transient endoneural anoxia due to acute nerve compression. It's a reversible condition. Within 15 minutes, numbness and tingling occurs. After 30 minutes, loss of pain and sensibility. After 45 minutes, muscle weakness and relief of compression is followed by intense paresthesia up to 5 minutes and feeling restored within 30 seconds and full power after 10 minutes. Neuropraxia is a reversible physiological nerve conduction block in which there is a loss of some types of sensation and muscle power followed by spontaneous recovery after a few days or weeks. And causes due to mechanical pressure causing segmental demyelination. And seen in crutch palsy or tunique palsy. Axonotomesis is due to axonal interruption. The loss of conduction occurs, but the nerve is in continuity and the neural tubes are intact. Valerian degeneration, distal to lesion and few millimeters retrograde occurs. Axonal regeneration occurs within hours of nerve damage, which is, and recovery is 1 to 2 mm per day, and if they are not re-innervated within 2 years, they will never recover. Neurotemesis is division of a nerve trunk. Rapid valerian degeneration occurs, destruction of endoneural tubes over a variable segment, and scarring prevents regeneration of axons, and surgical repair is required. Function may be adequate, but it's never normal. So this is Seaton's 1942 grades of nerve injury. Neuropraxia is a conduction block. In axotemesis, axons are divided, and in nerve neurotemesis, nerve are divided. There is another classification, Sunderland's classification, in which in 1951 he said grade 1 is focal conduction block, no Müllerian degeneration. Number 2 is axonal disruption. 3 is axon plus endoneurium disruption. Number 4 is axon plus endoneurium plus perineurium disruption. And 5 is axon plus endoneurium plus perineurium plus epineurium disruption. So the diagnosis of a peripheral nerve injury depends primarily on precise history and exact clinical situation. The history is clinical features, inability to move a part of a limb. Number 2, weakness. Number 3, numbness. Number 4, cause may or may not be obvious. When the cause is obvious, the nerve affected and its level is easy to decide. When the cause is not obvious, history of injection in the nerve proximity, any medical causes like leprosy, diabetes should be inquired into. Following examination, observation should be made. You look at attitude and deformity. For example, you look at wrist drop, foot drop, winging of scapula, claw hand, ape hand deformity, pointing index, and policeman tip. Number 2, wasting of muscles, skin changes, pallor, cyanosis, it becomes dry, glossy and smooth, and trophic changes occur. Temperature changes, sensory loss, sweat test detects sympathetic function in the nerve supplied. So the presence of sweating within an autonomous zone of an injured peripheral nerve reassures that the total complete interruption of the nerve has not occurred. Next to follow are the starch test or ninhydrin test. Number 7 is motor examination. Let's have a look at the regional survey of nerve injuries. In the brachial plexus, we have the two most common injuries, the Erb palsy and the Klumke's palsy. In Erb's palsy, the injury of C5 and 6 and sometimes C7, common in overweight babies with shoulder dystocia at delivery. The abductors and external rotators of the shoulder and the supinators are paralyzed. Arm held to the side, internally rotated and pronated. This is what Erb palsy will look like. Klumke's palsy, on the other hand, is injury of C8-T1, usually after breech delivery of smaller babies. Baby lies within the arm supinated and elbow flexed. Loss of intrinsic muscle power in the hand. This is what a Klumke's palsy will look like. Long thoracic nerve injury, roots 3, 5, 6 and 7, supply serratus interior muscle. Injury causes paralysis of the muscle, causing winging of scapula. Complain of ache and weakness on the lifting the arm, and test by pushing against the wall. And this is what it looks like. And this is the test for long thoracic nerve injury for winging of right scapula. A spinal nerve injury, C2, C6, splice tendomastoid and upper half of trapezius. Injury causes severe pain and stiffness of the shoulder, reduced ability to hitch or hunch the shoulder, mild winging of the scapula that disappears on flexion or forward thrusting of the shoulder, and this is what a spinal nerve injury occurs. Axillary nerve C5-6 supplies the deltoid anterior spinal muscles. A cutaneous branch supplies the skin over the lower half of deltoid. The landmark is 5 cm below the tip of acromion. Injury causes shoulder weakness and wasting of deltoid muscles, and abduction can be initiated but cannot be maintained. Extension of the shoulder with arm abducted to 90 degrees impossible, and small area over the deltoid, which is called the Sargent's patch sign, is seen. And test stabilizes scapula with one hand while the other hand is kept on the deltoid to feel for its contraction. Patient asks to abduct its shoulder. Inability to abduct the shoulder in the absence of deltoid becoming taut indicates deltoid paralysis. Radial nerve is a continuation of the posterior cord of brachial plexus C5 to C8 and T1, and this is the course of a nerve. And you see its branches, what it supplies, the motor branches, so it depends on the site of it. This is the radial nerve is vulnerable to injury below the spinal groove, where there is a fracture in the distal third of humeral shaft. So external carpi radialis, longus, external carpi radialis, brevis are gone. Test for radial nerve proximal to distal following muscles can be examined. Examine the triceps for contraction brachioradialis, keeping the arm in mid prone, and ask the resistance. Brachioradialis stands out and can be felt. This is a wrist drop occurs in the wrist extensors. Paralysis brachioradialis. Extensor carpi radialis, longus, extensor carpi radialis, brevis, extensor digitorum, extensor carpi ulnaris, also called sagittal night palsy. This is what it looks like. This is what the radial nerve results from acute trauma or compression of the radial nerve. Finger drop occurs at extension of MCP joint, and for extensor pulses, longest function extensor IPJ of thumb. This is a pin test, is a branch of the radial nerve, purely motor innervation to the extensor compartment, finger metacarpal extension weakness, wrist extension weakness. This is what it looks like. This is the median nerve, and where the course of median nerve. And this is the motor branches in the forearm, distal one-third in the hand. Low lesions, these are high lesions. Typically, hand is held with ulnar fingers flexed and index straight. This is the pointing sign. And characteristic pinch defect, patient pinches with distal joints in full extension. So, check for flex the pollicis longus. And flexor digitorum superficialis. This is what it looks like, a pointing test on asking the patient to make a fist, index finger remains straight. This occurs due to paralysis of both flexors of index finger due to median nerve palsy at the level proximal to elbow. So flexor carpi radialis in a patient with paralysis of this muscle, the wrist deviates to ulnar side while palmar flexion occurs. Abductor pollicis brevis, function is abduction of thumb. You pen test, patient asked to lay his hand flat on the table with palm facing the ceiling, and the pen is held above the thumb. and asked him to touch the pen with the tip of his thumb. This is what a pen test is. Opponents to oppose the thumb, the tip of the thumb to other fingers. This is anterior interossei nerve palsy patient unable to make an OK sign test FDP and FPL. Ape hand deformity, median nerve palsy, wasting of thenar muscles, inability to oppose or flex, thumb is in the same plane as the wrist, test thenar eminences. Ulnar nerve, it arises from the medial quadrubrachial plexus, root value C, 7, 8 and T1. This is the course of the ulnar nerve and its branches. Motor branches in the arm, low lesions will cause this, high lesions will cause this. So examination of individual fingers is important. In the case of ulnar nerve, flexor carpi ulnaris, ask the patient to flex the wrist against gravity and the hand deviates to the radial side. Abducted digiti minimi, ask the patient to abduct the little finger against resistance while keeping the hand flat on the table. The interossei, palmar interossei do adduction, pad, and dorsal interossei do abduction, dab. So palmar, pad, dorsal, dab. AGAVA stresses for dorsal interossei abductors of the middle finger. With the hand kept on the flat table, palmar surface down, patient is asked to move its middle finger sideways. First dorsal interossei can be separately examined by asking the patient to abduct the index finger against resistance. This is the Gawa's test. Card test for palmar interossei adductors of the fingers. Insert a card between two extended fingers and ask the patient to hold tightly. The examiners try to pull the card out. In the case of weak palmar interossei, it is easy to pull out the card. Claw hand is hyperextension of MCP joint and flexion at PIP and DIP joints. This is a paralysis of lumbricals. So there is another paradox. Clawing is more marked in lower nerve palsy than higher nerve palsy, as flexors of fingers are also paralyzed. In ulnar nerve palsy, only medial two fingers develop clawing, while all four fingers develop clawing in combined median ulnar nerve. So this is a claw hand ulnar nerve palsy. We have just gone through electropolysis, Frohman's test, use of adductor pulses and first dorsal interossei. Patient will not be able to hold a book by using flexor pulses as long as supplied by median nerve in place of adductor. This produces flexor and IPJ of the thumb. This is a book test. Femoral nerve, the lower limb, called gunshot or a pressure attraction during operation of bleeding into the thigh. This is the features of quadriceps injury and patient is unable to extend the knee actively. Numbness on the anterior thigh and medial aspect of leg, and knee reflex is depressed, is severe neurological pain. So this is the course of the sciatic nerve, its branches and its nerve supply, mostly common in injured in traumatic hip dislocation posteriorly in pelvic fractures, and there is paralysis of all the hamstrings and all muscles below the knee, absent knee jerk, loss of sensation below knee except on the medial side of the leg, saphenous branch of the femoral nerve. Patient walks with wrist drop and a high stepping gait. This is a foot drop. The number two is a bending gait. This is a swing out gait and a step out gate. This is the three pictures shown on the right. They are the compensating for foot drop. So treatment of a nerve injury is conservative, splintage, preserve mobility of the joint, care of skin, nails, physiotherapy, relief of pain, operative is neurolysis, nerve repair, nerve grafting and nerve transfer. Neurolysis is application of physical or chemical agents to a nerve in order to cause a temporary degeneration of targeted nerve fibers and scar of operation as nerve is freed from enveloping scar, epineural fibrosis or external neurolysis or internal neurolysis where a nerve sheath may be dissected longitudinally to relieve pressure from the fibrous tissue within the nerve, interneural fibrosis. This nerve repair can be performed within a few days of injury or later. Primary repair is indication within first six to eight hours in clean sharp injuries and delay done in first 7 to 18 days when the wound is clean and there is no other signs of injury. And secondary repair is done in crushed avulsed injuries, delay at 3 to 6 weeks. These are techniques of nerve injuries, not required by you, but just for information. Epineural suture, epiperineural suture number 2, perineural suture and group fascicular repair. Nerve grafting is indicated if there is a loss of more than 10 cm or more, and end to end is likely to end in tension at suture line. A nerve graft is used, and the most commonly nerve used is the sural nerve. Other branches are given. So you bring a nerve, graft a nerve, and then position itself that is no tension on the repair. Signs of regeneration are tunnel sign on tapping gently over the nerve along its course from distal to proximal. A pin and needle sensation is felt in the area supplied by the nerve, and this progresses distally at 1 mm per day and can be marked. You do a motor examination and electrodiagnostic test, electromyography, nerve conduction studies. This is recording of electrical activity of a muscle at rest and during activity. It is to decide whether the nerve injury is present or whether it's complete or incomplete, whether a regeneration is occurring on the level of injury. And this is nerve conduction, is a measure of velocity of conduction of impulse in a nerve. So the normal nerve conduction velocity of a motor nerve is 70 m per second. This is what it decides factor that it will influence. And thank you very much.